You know what it is, welcome to the city. If you're looking for a way to plug in, we got plenty. All the news, all the vibes, take a look and see. Here we go, this is Rock the City TV.
Yo, what's good to all of God's beloved children watching us near and far? We are so honored to bring you another fully charged episode of Rock the City TV, the official online experience of City of Truth Church.
Yo, what a crazy month this week has been. No matter where you stand on the issues, we know there are so many things that could be weighing heavy on you right now, really from the whole year, not just last week.
Amen. Pastor and Lady J have a healthy saying, feel how you feel and choose joy.
Yes, choosing joy and being honest about our emotions don't have to be mutually exclusive. They can happen at the same time. We can take our fears and our concerns to the cross while also being intentional about aligning our thoughts and actions with God's word.
Yes, and at the end of the day, God is still God.
Yes!
Check this out.
Listen, we're totally confident in the God that we serve. Our God is victorious. He's always fighting for us. And because he's victorious, we are also victorious. So I want y'all to catch this song and y'all gonna sing it with us, all right? It's real simple. It goes like this. Enemies surround me, mountains before me. I won't be afraid, 'cause you go before me. Come on, you sing it, say.
Enemies surround me.
Come on, sing mountains before me.
Mountains before me. You've
been so good. y'all try to catch this and sing it with us. Say, you will never let me down. Say,
you will never let me down.
Hey, you will never let me down. Say,
you will never let me down.
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 All I gotta do is look back.
Look back.
All I gotta do is look back.
Look back.
OMG, City Worship, please continue to take us to the King and bless my soul.
Worship is a great alternative to our usual social media indulgence. Instead of logging on to Facebook, hop on over to YouTube and catch some great worship sets on our YouTube channel, #thecitykc.
Period. And instead of being focused on staying in the know, it would benefit us more to stay in His presence.
Okay, okay. I see what you're doing.
Okay, okay. You know, Pastor has challenged us as a family to disengage from social media as much as possible for the remainder of November.
Yes, man. Feed your soul.
Yes.
And give your mind a much, 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 much needed break. Watch this. What's good, Swerve parents and students? It's Daisy and Trey here, and you already know. If we're here together, you know what I'm saying? Something is about to go D-O-W-N down.
Y'all, we missed y'all so much. Yes. We miss worshiping with y'all and having real conversations with y'all and just seeing y'all faces like every single Sunday.
Yes, and speaking of faces, starting next Sunday, November 15th,
okay.
Swerve will be having our own separate weekend experience, man. Just like the good old days.
Yes. And by faces though, Trey, don't you mean on Zoom, cuz coronavirus.
Of course. So join your family and us on Sundays at 11 a.m. for praise and worship on Rock the City TV.
Then, directly after praise and worship at 11:30, meet us on over on the Zoom room for a teaching and catching up led by me and Trey, starting with a brand new series titled Chaotic.
Ooh. And I can tell it's going to be crazy. So guess what? To access the Zoom link, text Swerve to 816-974-0013, and the link will be made available on the CityKC app as well.
And we cannot wait to see you all.
Yes, in real life.
Sort of.
I mean, kind
of. You're doing too much. You always Zoom.
All right.
Zoom.
All I want to do is zoom. Hey, all I want to do is zoom. Hey.
Yo, what's up, City of Truth? Pastor 83 here. And I interrupt this weekend broadcast just to come to you for two things. Number one, I want to tell you that I love you. I say this a lot because y'all don't know how bad I mean it. Like, I mean it with everything that I have. Like, being a pastor is one of the greatest honors and privileges of my life. I was born to be a pastor. I was born to be a shepherd. I was born to feed, lead, and protect the sheep of God. And I miss you guys so much. Some of you, I've had the privilege of seeing like out places or seeing you guys here. Some of you came through to pick up some of your Fearless merch. If you have not got your Fearless merch, pick it up at fearless.faith. Pick that up. And some of you just bursting in tears. I'm fighting back tears. Lady J crying because, you know, she does not hold back tears. She will cry at the drop of a hat. It's just something about them prayer warriors, man. It's real sensitive. No, but I miss you guys and love you guys. And I want you to really hold on. Hold on. The Lord is working behind the scenes and He's opening up doors. I don't like to tell you things prematurely, but just know your boy's working on some stuff. All right. Second reason I'm here is to receive our offering. I don't want your fatigue to affect your faithfulness. I don't want your fatigue of this current season, this climate, the fact that we can't meet with each other in person, because sometimes out of sight or just not being here physically is kind of out of mind. It's like, oh, my church will be fine, but really, we need you. Your church needs you. Our staff needs you. Ministry needs you. We're entering into the end of the year. This is the last part of the stretch of the year that we want to really end strong financially. Thanksgiving and Christmas, we still want to be a blessing, whether we have to be a blessing remotely or in person. We want to make sure we feed people for Thanksgiving, and we want to make sure we take care of some children and families and stuff like that. And that's only going to be possible through your donations. So I don't want the fatigue to affect your faithfulness now. Your church still grinding, right? Still paying our staff. You're still taking care of me and my family, which is a blessing. You know, I always keep it a buck with you, transparent. There's no, you know, game series, what you do. I preach the gospel, also live based on the gospel that I preach. And so I just want to thank you guys for making sure that my family has what we need and the church has what we need and the city has what it needs. I read a quote by Randy Alcorn concerning generosity. He said this, he says, if we were to gain God's perspective, if we were to gain God's perspective, even for a moment, and we were to look at the way we go through life, accumulating and hoarding and displaying all of our stuff, we would have the same feelings of horror and pity that any sane person has when he or she views people in an insane asylum, endlessly beating their heads against the wall. He said, if we were to gain God's perspective and we were to watch us accumulating stuff and hoarding stuff and displaying all the stuff we got with the money we got, he says we would have the same feelings a sane person has when he sees an insane person beating their head against the wall. So the first question about money is, I want to ask you is, how do you see money? I want to dissect real quick. How do you see money? How do you see it? Do you see money as the ultimate solution to your life? Like, do you say stuff like, if only I had this check, I'd be straight. If only I had this raise, I'd be cool. All of my problems would go away if I could just have more. Is that you? Or do you see money as hard to get and easy to let go of? Do you see money as, I'll never have enough, I'm going to always struggle? Or the flip side of this, the polar opposite of this is, it's just money, I'm going to get paid next week. Turn up. You know what I'm saying? Is that you? Are you that irresponsible person that you're just like, I'm grown, I do what I want to do, I'll get paid next week, so I'll go hungry for 3 days until I get paid and I'm going to turn up again? Or there may be some of you who's watching me now and you see it as evil or problematic, right? You see money as evil. You misquote scriptures like, money is the root of all evil. But that's not what Paul says. Paul doesn't say money is the root of all evil. He says the love of money is the root of all evil, aka greed, right? The root of all evil is greed. So my question for you today, City of Truth, is how do you see money? And I want to illustrate to you why I'm asking you this. I always mention stuff like this, but my members who are watching me know that I like gangster movies and I like true crime movies. And I love shows, and the reason I like it, rather, is because I love stuff that can keep my attention and make me feel like I'm part of the story. And so I love shows that cause me to have to do my couch investigation. Like, I love trying to figure out, you know, who done it, you know? Like, I like figuring out, it was him. And then at the end of the show, looking at Lady J, telling her how right I was. And one of my favorite shows of all time is Criminal Minds. And with shows like this, every single time they bring a witness in to be questioned, the witness doesn't think that what they've seen is significant, but a good detective is able to piece together all these different perspectives from these different witnesses in order to see this bigger picture. And I say that to say is, have you ever wondered how it is that several people can see the exact same thing, but have totally different testimonies about what they've seen? And in the same way, all of us know what money is. All of us have seen money. All of us have used money. All of us know we need money, but not everybody in here responds to money the same way. Why? Here's why. Because how you see money determines how you respond to money. How you see it determines how you'll respond to it. Your perspective of money will determine how you use it. Simply put, how you see it affects how you use it. And so I say all that to say that God, as a loving father, teaches us in his word how to look at money. And I'll tell you this. If you take heed to what the Bible says, and you take heed to what God says, and you command your soul to receive what he has to say about money, if you command your soul to receive what he says as life and power instead of just suggestions, I can guarantee you that your life will reach revolutionary levels of freedom. And this even applies to how you view money. God has given you resources for you to fund his kingdom agenda. That God has given you resources for you to begin to part ways with the love of money and say, you know what, God, you are the source of all things. And you gave me my job and you gave me this income for me to be a good steward over. And the first order to be a good steward is to put in your hands what you gave me and for you to command me to use it however you see fit. And so that's what I'm going to ask you. I'm going to ask you right now, whether this is your first time or you're just a systematic giver and you, this is what you do. I'm asking you to give today, giving God your resources and saying, God, you tell me what to do with them. There are several ways you can give. They're posted a link for those of you who are watching online. But there are several ways you can give. The first way is text to give. You can text the keyword, the City KC, and you can text that to the number 77977. You'll get a link back and you can set up even reoccurring giving. A lot of people are using that, by the way. Recurring giving, when they don't even, Uncle Sam automatically take his stuff out and you automatically give to the kingdom. A lot of people set that up, but you can do that by texting the City KC, sending that to the number 77977, or you can give via Cash App using Cash Tag the City KC. Listen, your pastor loves you, and I just want you to be a whole disciple of Jesus Christ. And that includes how you view money. Don't be afraid of it. Don't be scared of it. God gave it to you. He knows we need it, right? He owns it all. He'll make sure you have everything that you need. But God wants your heart separate from the love of money, right? God bless you. I love you. Let's continue to worship.
Unravel me with the melody you surround me with, a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fear are gone. I'm no longer I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, oh, from my mother. Chosen me, your love has called my name.
I've been born again,
I've been born again into your family.
Your blood flows,
your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am. But I am a child of God.
I'm no longer a slave to fear, but I am a child of God. Hallelujah. I am a child. I am your child. I am your child. I am your child.
Most people, if they had really learned to look into their own hearts, would know they do want, and want acutely, something that can't be had in this world. There are all sorts of things in this world that offer to give it to you, but they never quite keep their promise. If I find in myself a desire in which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world.
Yo, what's up, City of Truth? Pastor AD3 here. Obviously, I'm here with you for another amazing weekend at the city. We've been online since March. And I don't know, I've kind of been sensing a little online fatigue, but I want you to remember to lean into what we're doing because it is extremely beneficial to your spiritual health and well-being. This right now is our reality. So within this reality, I want you to embrace it, and I want you to pray and ask the Lord to renew your strength when it comes to the reality of us meeting online. Well, in case you've been living under a rock, and you probably haven't if you figured out how to get online and watch this, you know that all week long, literally since Tuesday, all week long, there's been an election that has been taking place, and votes have been counted, and record turnout, and we finally know the results of this particular election. And some of us feel ways, and then some of us feel the opposite ways, which is fine. You can feel how you feel. There's no law or biblical mandate against feelings, but there is a biblical mandate against divisions. And so I want you to feel how you feel. You have permission to do so. But I want you, and I'll talk about this a little bit more in a minute. I don't want you to let those feelings to drive a wedge and cause a division between you and your brothers and your sisters. I told you guys via social media that I would give this election one weekend. I would give this election how many weekends? Somebody type one in the comments right now. Just type one in the comments, all right? Now, I said what I said, and I said what I said for a reason. Those of you guys who have been under my leadership for any considerable amount of time, you know that I am not what I call a responsive leader, or a leader that is reactionary or reacts based on what's happening in the world. I never want to be reactionary. What I am is prophetic. So I will speak to an issue. I will give insight to an issue. I will give light and clarity to an issue and speak what I feel, thus saith the Lord, according to scripture. But what I won't do is allow every little thing in our culture and allow every little thing in our world to cause me to devote huge amounts of time to it disproportionately. All right. So that's what I mean by giving it one weekend. Obviously, if something pops off and I need to speak to it, I'm going to speak to it. But I've never been reactionary. I've always been prophetic. Which means I want to be in a position where I afflict the comfortable, but also comfort the afflicted. And so that's my responsibility as your pastor. That's my responsibility as a pastor. That is my responsibility as an under shepherd in the church of Jesus Christ, is to be prophetic and not be what Paul says, carried about by every wind of doctrine. Here's something over here. Can you talk about this? Here's something over here. Can you talk about this? Well, what about this? And what about this? No, I'm going to talk about the word of God. I'm going to preach the gospel. I'm going to use wisdom and understanding. And I'm going to speak to you what thus saith the Lord. That's why you follow me. That's why you've been following me all these years. And I love you for it. And I know you love me for it. I'm going to always be honest with you. Always. I'm going to keep it 100 with you. And so I wanted to say that. But so here's the one weekend. This is not obligatory. I'm honored and blessed to be able to be here. This is not something I'm just doing because I feel like I have to. This is something I need to do, right? This is important to you. This is important to me. This is important to our life. All right. I want you to get your Bibles and I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 13. I do have a little bit of an audience in here. Hebrews chapter 13. And we're going to look at verses 5 through 8. Hebrews 13, verses 5 through 8. And it says this. It says, don't be obsessed with money, but live content with what you have. For you always have God's presence. For hasn't he promised you that I will never leave you alone, never, and I will not loosen my grip on your life? So we can say with great confidence, I know the Lord is for me, and I will never be afraid of what people may do to me. Don't forget the example of your spiritual leaders who have spoken God's messages to you. Take a close look at how their lives ended and then follow their walk of faith. Jesus, my, the anointed one, is always, here it is, the same yesterday, today, and forever. It says, don't be obsessed with money, but live content with what you have, for you always have God's presence. Then it says, Jesus, my, the anointed one, is always the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm still in the homeless series, and I want to talk to you from the topic, keep counting. Somebody type, keep counting. All right, keep counting. And obviously that's from what was taking place this week, how there were some who were saying stop counting, there were some who were saying keep counting, there were some who were saying keep counting and stop counting at the same time. But the message today is keep counting. I want to read something for you real quick. I posted this on Facebook. I want to read this to you, and I'm going to pull my phone out and read it because this is my message, not exhaustive, but this is my message from me to you. It says this, City of Truth Church, we will not be scoffers. We will not find joy in the disappointment of others. We will not celebrate as those without hope. Our hope is in Christ. We will be gracious. We will be loving. We will be kind. And we will continue to trust our King. Our salvation does not come from the White House, but from heaven. We are homeless in this world. Our home is in heaven. You have the liberty to be happy if this was your desired outcome. You have that liberty. It is not okay, however, to use this liberty as a license to sin against your brother or sister who may believe differently. I put this in stars, obviously written to my members who voted for the outcome, right? The newly elected president-elect Joe Biden. But this is to my members who voted differently. I love you. I'm praying for you. You used your democratic right to vote. This outcome was not what you wanted, and that's okay. I do want you to know that because others voted differently, in no way makes your brother and sister any less a Jesus person than you are. Why, Pastor? Because salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone. Continue to trust Jesus. This election is but a small speck in the book of God's grand scheme. I love you. Use wisdom. Love always. Pastor AD3. And so as we face our love for security on our terms, as we face our love for security on our terms or on the world's terms, few verses hit like Hebrews chapter 13, 5 and 6. First, Paul says, don't be obsessed with money, But he says, live content with what you have, for you always have God's presence. So Paul is letting us know this isn't a feeling. This isn't a craving. This love for money, or this love for power, or this love for security is a passion. So he's communicating this to these people like this is a passion. This is a longing. This is a passionate desire for a certain level of security, a certain level of peace. And he's saying that we think things and people is going to give it to us. And if you don't think this is us, you don't think this is people, if you don't think this is fallen creation, then you are sadly mistaken. And politically speaking, this is both sides of the aisle. And so he says, don't have a love for money. And I want to parenthetically insert this about money in this text. Money in this text is obviously money, but it also symbolizes the things the world considers security. It symbolizes the things the world considers security. So it can be money or power or influence, or in this case of our climate this week, it can also be the security we believe comes based on who's in the White House. So no matter how you voted, as a Christian and specifically a Christian that belongs to the local expression of the body of Christ, which is City of Truth Church, I'm your pastor, so I'm talking to you. We do not teach or condone divisiveness based on political systems or systems of the world. So Paul lets us know that this belief system comes from something. He says this belief system comes from a lack of contentment in Jesus. How do you know you have a lack of contentment in Jesus? In context, when it comes to this political climate, is that you're still championing for your saviors, small s. So the first thing I need you to keep counting on is this. Write this down. Keep counting on the power of contentment. Keep counting on the power of contentment. And so what is biblical contentment? What is this thing called contentment? I know we've heard this word a lot, and we have read this word a lot. We've taught this word a lot. But what is biblical contentment? It is a satisfaction, and it is a fulfillment that comes from whose we are. It is a satisfaction and it is a fulfillment that comes from whose we are, which in turn informs what we have and who we are. What is biblical contentment? It is a satisfaction. It is a fulfillment that comes from whose we are. And this fulfillment that comes from whose we are then informs the things we have and what we do with them, and who we are and how we see ourselves. I've heard it put like this. Contentment is the direct fruit of having no higher ambition than to belong to the Lord at his disposal. Contentment is the direct fruit of having no higher ambition than to belong to the Lord at his disposal. Contentment is, God, do whatever you want to do. You're my Father, you're my God, you're my King, and I trust you. So as it relates to the outcome of this election, my question for you is this. On whatever side of the aisle you voted for, do you trust God enough to grab a hold of contentment in him? And so what are the signs of contentment? Number one, peace. And inward, it is well. Number two, love. Able to remain a light in the areas you are. And number three, rest. Knowing that God is in control. And so my question is, do you trust God enough to grab hold of contentment in him? How do I know I have contentment? Is there peace inside of me? Is there an it is well in my soul? Is there love? Am I still able to show love? Am I able to remain a light to the people around me? And am I at rest? Is my soul at rest? What does that mean? Do I know that God is in control? But I want to draw your attention to what Paul attaches to this contentment. He says in this verse, he says, don't be obsessed with money or power or influence. He says, but live content with what you have. Everybody say contentment. He says, for you always have God's presence. Now, you can underline the word for because that's an active word. He says, you need to be content. And here's how you're going to be content. He says, because you always have God's presence. Another translation says, I will never leave you. God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So he lets them know that the things they think are power won't be with them always. That's what he says. He says, all the stuff that y'all think make y'all secure and all the stuff you think makes you safe and makes you prominent and safeguards your life and all your freedoms you have. Paul's reminding them that all of those things will pass away. So all the things you think are power and influence won't be with you always. And he does this by reminding them what they'll always have. So he lets them know the stuff they think they'll always have, they won't always have. And he does this by reminding them of what they'll always have. He says, listen, y'all, you will always have God. He says, you won't always get what you want, but you'll always have God. He says, you won't always understand the ways of God, but you will always have God. He says, you won't always agree with the moves of God, but you will always have God. And this is how the flames of contentment are fanned, through the presence of God. No material thing can satisfy me like him. No political agenda can protect me like him. No president can calm me like him, can lead me like him. Hear me. Biblical contentment will only be enough for you when it is connected to the presence of God. Contentment. That's what I feel we need as believers. I'm talking the City of Truth Church. Contentment. So what's the key to weathering this season? The key to this season and every season is found in Philippians chapter 4. Look at verse 11. We're going to look at two verses. Paul says, I don't say any of the things I just told you out of need, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I find myself in. Wait a minute, Paul. You use the word learn. So contentment is not automatic? No, it is not. Contentment is learned. He says, I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I find myself in. I know how to make do with little, and I know how to make do with a lot. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being content, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in abundance or in need. I am able to do all things through him who strengthens me. There is no real contentment apart from him who strengthens me. And if I'm going to be content, connected to him who strengthens me, I have to look at him who strengthens me as the only person who's able to strengthen me. And so I want to impart contentment to you. I want to impart the kind of contentment to you that does not look to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, that does not look to a political party, that does not look to a husband, that does not look to a wife, that does not look to an occupation, but looks to a king that is the King of Kings, that is the Lord of Lords, who is able to strengthen me where I need to be strengthened in order for me to activate the contentment in my spirit. And so what is this about? This is about our perspective and our definition of reliability. Type that in the box. Reliability. Your attitude concerning what just took place in our nation is a revelation of where your perspective and definition of reliability lies. Reliability. I didn't say liability. I said reliability. Who's most reliable to you? Is the Republican Party most reliable to you? Is the Democratic Party most reliable to you? Or is the sovereign God of heaven most reliable to you? If reliability to you comes only from the White House, then your contentment will constantly take a hit. It's going to. You're not going to be content. You're not. You're going to be fearful. You're going to be wondering what's happening. You're going to be wondering what China going to do to us and what Russia going to do to us. And you're going to be wondering what wars are going to happen. And you're going to be wondering what's going to happen to my food and what's going to happen to my family. Because your reliability is placed in a person that's in a house. Y'all not hearing what I'm saying, man. Oh, God, where was I? Oh, yeah, reliability. But the key to recalibrating your reliability and aligning it with righteousness, the key to recalibrating your reliability and aligning it with righteousness is looking at the history of God. If you look at God's history as evidence of God's reliability, then your contentment will be strengthened. What do you mean? God has a history of taking care of his people. David said, I was young and now I'm old, but I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. So is life about being on the right side of politics or being in righteousness? If you look at God's history as the evidence of his reliability, then your contentment will be strengthened. God has a history of taking care of his babies. God has a history of parting Red Seas. God has a history of miracle working power. God has a history of glory. God has a history of feeding thousands with two fish and five loaves. God has a history of opening blind eyes. God has a history of making ways out of no ways. God has a history, watch this, of protecting his people, no matter who's in power over a nation. Do you hear me? For some of you who are afraid of a leftist agenda, you don't need to be afraid of a leftist agenda or a right agenda. You are in the righteousness of God if you belong to Jesus. And no matter who is in political power over Babylon, your king is the king of all kings. Come on, somebody. God never tells us to be overly concerned with Babylonian affairs. So Paul goes from that. He talks about contentment. And so he said, so the first keep, this, the message is keep counting. So the first point is keep counting on the power of contentment. Something about contentment. Everybody around you is shaken, but you're content. That everybody around you is fearful, but you're content. You're going to go to work on Monday, and people are going to be talking and saying stuff, but there's going to be a peace inside of your spirit that the world didn't give you. And if the world didn't give it to you, what grandma used to say, the world can't take it away. So keep counting on the power of contentment. And then Paul says this, and I'm going to briefly be here. How long I've been up here? About 20 minutes, 25 minutes? 23 minutes, okay, good. Then he says, don't forget the example of your spiritual leaders. Why, Paul? Because they have spoken God's words to you. What do we need to do because of that? You need to take a close look at their lives and then follow their walk of faith. So first I talked about keep counting on the power of contentment. Next I want to say, according to this text, keep counting on the need for godly examples. Why am I saying this? Lady J and I have tried to show you what godliness and Christ-like character looks like in leadership. We've tried to show you that. We've tried to show you what integrity looks like in leadership. We've tried to show you what godliness looks like in leadership. I've tried to show you what faithfulness to one woman looks like in leadership. My wife has tried to show you what honor to her husband looks like in leadership. And so Christ-like character, Paul is saying, I need you to know what Christ-like character looks like in leadership. And here's the thing. And with God, God knows that in order to maintain contentment, you're going to need godly examples and godly instruction on how to live it out in this world. He says, you just are. He says, you're definitely going to need leadership in this world in order to help you live out what contentment looks like. And so Paul says, according to the text, Paul says, don't forget their example. He says, don't forget the example of your spiritual leaders who have spoken God's messages to you. So the first thing that Paul wants us to know is that leaders speak. What does leadership speak? Leadership speaks the word of God to you. Leadership speaks the blessings of God over you. Leadership speaks life into you, encouragement into you, health in you. There are many of you who have come to our church, and before you got here, you didn't even know what was in you, but something I said over the stage ignited something on the inside of you. Now you're doing stuff you never thought you'd do. Some of you are finishing school, and some of you have jobs that you never thought you'd be qualified for. And some of you are working in fields that you never thought you'd work in. There's full-time staff who works here who went and got degrees in other places, but when they walk through the doors and begin to submit themselves to leadership, the words Lady J and I begin to speak into them set on fire something on the inside of them, and they begin to walk the will of God out for their life and forsook the will that they had for their life. And so Paul lets us know that in order to continue to foster contentment, you're going to need leadership, and those leaders are going to have to speak, and they're not going to just be, they're not going to need to speak their own words. They're going to have to speak the word of God. Then Paul says, not only are you going to need leaders who speak, but you're going to need leaders who live. And so the first thing is leaders speak. The second is leaders live. What do they live? They live what they speak into you. If there's leaders in your life whose lives don't look like the words that they say, they are not the examples God has put in your life. Since when do Christians stop looking at the lives of leaders? Across the board. We are politically homeless. We don't put our whole stock in anybody. So with the power and influence of leadership comes a responsibility to live at that level of authority. So according to the text, we got to keep counting on examples, godly examples in leadership. Keep counting, keep counting. Somebody say keep counting, keep counting, keep counting. On godly leadership and character mattering. Keep counting on that. Then Paul concludes with this. He says, Jesus, the anointed one, is always the same yesterday, today, and forever. Last thing I need to tell you, which is probably my favorite thing about God. The first one is keep counting on the power of contentment. Second one is keep counting on a godly example of leadership. The third one is keep counting on the immutability of Jesus. Immutability, that's a big word. I'm going to break it down in a minute. The immutable nature of God is his unchanging nature. Paul said he's the same. Somebody say he's the same. How much stuff has changed this year? How much things have changed this year? How many of your norms are no longer your norms that used to be your norms? Please don't judge the nature of Jesus based on the nature of the culture. Keep counting on the immutability of Jesus, the unchanging nature of Jesus, the immutability of Jesus. For those who are fearful of the future, for those who are afraid of what may come next, for those who are scared of what may happen, for those who may be scared of a political agenda, please understand that we serve an all-powerful and all-immutable God. Immutability means, what does it mean? It means that God does not need to get additional information and that God does not need to deal with circumstances that surprise him. Why? Because nothing surprises him. That God is not sitting in heaven waiting. He wasn't waiting on us to vote before he decided his plan. He wasn't waiting on you to cast your ballot before he enacted his plan. He's like, oh man, Holy Ghost, don't go yet. We got to wait on them to vote. Now, you know, however they vote depends. So I got a plan A and I got a plan B. And if they vote this way, then we're going to initiate plan A. But if they vote this way, then we're going to initiate plan B. It's up to them. That makes you God and not him. God has one plan and has had that plan before the foundation of the world. As a matter of fact, he said the lamb was slain before the foundation of the world, which means God's plan A, B, C through Z is Jesus. The plan is already done. The fight is already fixed. As a matter of fact, the book of Revelation is not about fear. The book of Revelation is about victory. It is about the fulfillment of a plan that God had from the beginning. So the immutable nature of God means that God doesn't need to gather additional information for him to make choices. Choice been made. The immutable nature of God means that God doesn't need to deal with circumstances that come on him by surprise, because don't nothing surprise God. I'm fussing, but I don't care. Immutability. Somebody say immutability. That's one of my favorite character traits and nature traits about God. Immutability. Immutability also means that God does not alter his plans as a result of our behavior. Somebody needed to hear that, because somebody in here thinking God forgot about you. Somebody in here thinking that you done made too many mistakes for God to use you the way he purposed to use you. The devil is a lie. That would make your mistakes more powerful than your maker. That would make your mistakes more powerful than your master. The immutable nature of God means that God does not alter his plans as a result of your behavior. He's not over here checking his list and checking it twice, trying to find out who's naughty or nice. God is like, I know the plans, Jeremiah 29:11, that I have for you. Plans of peace to give you a future and a hope and an expected end. God is not changing his plans based on my choices. Yeah. What does that mean? That means that while I'm still accountable for what I do, that my actions are only going to accomplish what God has decided beforehand should happen. Hence the scripture, y'all favorite scripture that you like to quote, all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord and are called. Why? Can I preach to you real quick? Why would God command us to forbear one another in love if he won't do that with us? The word forbearance means leave room for their humanity. Why would God command you to do something his character won't have him do? That God's forbearance is God's grace. That nothing you do messes up my love for you. That nothing you do messes up my plans for you. That none of your actions change my mind about. Can I preach to somebody in here who can shout that God has not changed his mind about you? He still loves you. He still wants to bless you. He's still gonna change you. He's still gonna save who he told you he was gonna save. God doesn't change God's plans. They are still on track. God is still God. God is still seated on the throne. God is still good. And God is still just. Yeah. Ooh, Jesus. Somebody say he's immutable. He's unchanging. Y'all don't shout enough about that. We don't shout enough about the unchanging nature of God. He does not change. None of this is, God is not panicking in heaven like, oh my God, there comes a riot. Oh my God, there comes a protest. Oh my God, here comes Joe Biden. Oh my God, there goes Donald Trump. He's not complaining. He is not worrying. He is not, God is immutable. God is God. Yeah. And so I'm done fussing at y'all. But I wanted to bring this up. Now, I'm not one of them prophets that y'all been seeing prophesy on TV or social media with the outcomes of the election. God don't talk to me about that kind of stuff. And I'm glad he don't. That's way too big of a burden to bear for me. I ain't. Plus, for those who know me, you know I can't hold water in a paper bag. Y'all know I can't. So if God tell me something, I gotta tell it, all right? But God don't miss you. But one thing he did tell me, because I was praying for you. And let me tell you about my life. As a pastor, for those of you who don't understand this, let me let you in on it. My life is consumed with thinking and praying about you. And so this election, I'm good. my worries were for you. My longing was for you. And so I was asking the Lord, Lord, like, give me something. Tell me something. And somebody had bought me this a couple of weeks ago and brought it to me. And I wanted to wear it. And this is just how God talked to me. And he said that after this election, you're going to be able to wear that hoodie. So no matter, he didn't tell me which way it was going and all that stuff. He just told me. So whether it was Trump or whether it was Biden, I was going to wear this hoodie anyway. Ask Lady J. But I think this is prophetic. I want to leave you with this. The person at the helm of this nation is not responsible for the healing of this nation. The person at the helm of this nation, although the person at the helm of this nation can be responsible for the deep hurt of the nation, the person at the helm of the nation is not ultimately responsible for the deep healing of the nation. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name, my people will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. So according to that text, who is responsible for the deep healing of this nation? Ultimately, God has the power to do it. But God says, if my people humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn, I'll hear it and I'll heal. So I want to challenge you, regardless of if this election turned out the way that you wanted it to turn out, I want to challenge you to let the healing begin in you. Repent. You've said some stuff, thought some stuff, believed some stuff that you know you shouldn't have thought, said, and believed. You've reacted in ways that you know you shouldn't have reacted. You've spoken on things that you know you shouldn't have spoken on. And I believe that God is calling us as his people to repentance. Not checking people and making these prophetic declarations about the consumption of American life and democracy, but a real heartfelt, humble, broken repentance that says, God, I'm the problem. And I believe by faith that healing will come to you. Before we go, I want the worship team to come and they're going to sing what they sang last week, the blessing. But I want to, some of y'all didn't even know it was a scripture. I want to read it over you. And after I read it, I want them to come and sing it. And I really want you to let this permeate in your being. Really worship to this. Really meditate to this. They're posting a link for those of you who want to give your life to Jesus, this immutable Savior. They're posting a link right now. You can click that. Somebody will contact you and lead you to Jesus. But I want to read Numbers 6, 22 through 27. The Lord spoke to Moses saying, speak to Aaron and his sons, saying, thus you shall bless the people of Israel. You shall say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. So shall they put my name upon the people of Israel, and I will bless them. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. And make his face shine on you and give you peace. Remember, keep counting on the power of contentment. Keep counting on the example of godly leadership. And what else? Keep counting on the immutability of God. That he is a God that will not change. Paul said, he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. In Jesus' name, God bless you.
Yeah.
OM goodness. All I can say is that I am so grateful for great leadership and an even better God.
Facts, we might just keep that one on repeat for the rest of November and probably early December too. And I might leak it into 2021, really.
Point is, that's one of those you gotta keep on deck. Yeah. Watch it, rewatch it, share it. Yes. Everybody and their mama could use a little more hope and perspective to wrap up 2020.
And pray without ceasing, saints.
Oh, please.
We serve a good and faithful God, and we gonna be all right. We
gonna be all right. Change is here, y'all.
We gonna be all right. We gonna be all right. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gonna be all right.
Check this out.
Yes.
That's a good word, bro. That's a good word.
Some little kid sneezed on the back of my neck. I got sick after that. I was like, man.
And be intentional about aligning our thoughts and our actions. I don't know.
Never would have made it.
Sorry, Glenn. I know I messed up.
Hey, I'll be hooded in the mug, but I will pull up to
hey,
that Starbucks.
Let me get a tall macchiato.
Yep. Need habits, and this is moving way too fast for me to catch up.
Oh, okay.
But I know it was some great content in there, man. So make sure you check out the City of KC on YouTube. If we here together, that means something is about to go down.
That was awkward.
All right.
You good, dude?
I got chipped my tooth, but just let yourself go.
Yeah.
Then we gonna be all right. Hey, we gonna
no
be
tray.
All right. What?
That was perfect. All right, let's.
Then we gon' be alright.
We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me?
We gon' be alright.